Welcome to Green Living. Now, one of the sure signs of a really hard workout is excessive sweating. And it's not a pretty sight, is it? Now, you can replace these lost fluids with a cold glass of water, vitamin-enhanced waters, or you can do what athletes swear by and stock up on athletic drinks, which are loaded with electrolytes. Or if you're like me, you can choose something with a little more flavor, but is still packed with nutrients. Know what it is yet? Well, don't think too hard. Just use your coconut.
Coconut water is the clear liquid that pools inside whole green coconuts. It's different from coconut milk, which is pressed from the fatty meat of the fruit. An 11-ounce serving of pure coconut water contains about 60 calories without the fat, a gram of protein, and about 15 grams of carbohydrates.
It's often described as nature's sports drink because it's packed with electrolytes and it has twice as much potassium as a banana. And recent studies have also shown that it also lowers your blood cholesterol. And to top it all off, it's delicious to boot. But that's not all this healthy fruit has to offer our bodies. So join me today as we discover the numerous other ways that we can use this amazing fruit.
But first off, good news for women on bikes from Ethel Fortuno. Legends and fairy tales have often put women on a delicate pedestal, but this empowered lady believes that taking risks and being part of the adventure makes a woman complete. All she has to do is pedal.
I figured since my husband loves biking so much, I guess it would be nice to join him. So that's how it all started. I realized there are very few women who know how to bike. First, because as children, we were not really taught the guy things like biking, for example. Women are more daring and would like to do things what men can do. And I believe that we could do whatever men can do. A lot of women ride bikes only in parks and in their subdivisions. But it's more than that. Riding the bike can be your lifestyle, like going out to the market, going out to the library, going to the grocery. Women learning how to ride the bike safely will be able to express themselves more and do whatever they want to do without the restriction of not being able to do something because of just the inability of riding the bike.
Now Ethel is on a mission to encourage more women to be part of her army. This will bring her closer to create a big impact on the environment. One woman at a time.
Someone told me about this group that teaches women how to bike, and I thought I was going to get in touch with her. I've always wanted to bike. Every year I list it in my New Year's resolution.
Well, okay. So actually, the first requirement para matuto magbike is una, hindi nakachinelas, which okay. Very good. And you wear a helmet because a helmet is the cheapest insurance. Okay. So you need to wear the helmet properly.
I was prohibited from biking by my parents. They had rather traumatic experiences of friends and children of friends getting injured, so they didn't want me getting anywhere near a bike.
If a woman wants to ride, to learn how to ride the bike, I teach this woman how to balance on two wheels. So first, I took out the pedals for you to balance first. Because I would like you to have the confidence of balancing on the bike before actually pedaling. After this person learns how to balance on two wheels, I teach her how to mount and dismount safely. And then we practice.
I was expecting falling and scratches and really embarrassing things happening. It was easier, and I guess that had a lot to do with my teacher being very encouraging and patient.
When she is able to ride the bike safely, then I try to take her outside the safe street, so where there are jeeps and cars. So doing that, it will boost her confidence. And then later on, we join another another bike organization, the Tiklop Society. The Tiklop Society offers a lot of night rides for newbies, so that you'll get to learn how to, you'll get to learn a lot of road skills and ride your bike safely. So that's one thing that, that I encourage my students to do. I would like to see a very strong presence of women bikers on the streets. As I've said earlier, we see a lot of women bike in the gym or in their subdivision or in the parks. Maybe we have the whole world to explore. If more women ride the bikes, that would be like how many percent of the population? Can you imagine that? And then as women, we are also heads of the family. As I've said, if you are a mother, you could be a very good role model. Hopefully, when you see a lot of women biking, hopefully there will be less women drivers, car drivers. So we will have cleaner air, we will have less traffic. I guess it will be better for our children, for the generation to come. Like my child sees me riding the bike instead of driving. So it could be inculcated in his mind that, oh, since my mom is riding the bike, maybe I could do that too, to go to school or to run errands. So in my family alone, instead of my husband and I taking a car individually when we go places, we just ride the bikes, and no carbon footprint, no gas money to spend. So within the family, we are becoming an example to our extended family. And then after that, to the community. So now we could see a lot of our friends riding the bike, biking to work. And I think it's great for us.
Ethel is a woman, and her greatest weapon against Mother Earth's worst enemy is the power to influence other people. She calls out to more women to take on this adventure with her.
Let's take UP for example. UP does not have a bike lane before. Maybe because there are not a lot of bikers initially, but now that there are more, so they put the bike lanes. And there, and then having this bike lane increased the number of bikers more. As a result, even at this time, 12 in the afternoon, it's still cool. Mainly because of the less cars that are being used, since most of the people are riding the bikes now. It will be really nice if we see a lot of women ride the bike. Let us express ourselves so that we can be emulated by a lot of children. Feel the wind on our face and feel how it is to ride the bike. It's like using your bicycle as a lifestyle. That's one of my advocacies too. I use my bike as an everyday, as part of my life. Go anywhere, ride the bike. Attend parties, ride the bike. Attend the reunion on a bike. And that's what my husband and I have been doing. So hopefully, when more people are biking, people will be happier.
Welcome back to Green Living. Well, as you can see, I'm all freshened up and refreshed thanks to a nice cool shower and a tall glass of this coconut water right over here. But we all know that the coconut holds so much more than just this liquid.
In fact, the coconut is highly beneficial nutritiously and is rich in fiber, vitamins, and minerals. It's classified as functional food because it provides many health benefits beyond its nutritional content. One of the fruit's many byproducts is coconut oil. Coconut oil is a fantastic product because it possesses healing properties way beyond any other dietary oil, and is extensively used in traditional medicine, especially in the Asian regions.
And coconut oil can be used in numerous other ways, most of them outside the body.
Used topically, coconut oil acts as a wonderful moisturizer for all types of skin. Coconut oil is a safe solution for preventing dryness and flaking of skin, and it makes a perfect massage oil as well. It's known to delay the arrival of wrinkles and the sagging of skin that comes with age.
You can also use coconut oil as a lotion, as an eye makeup remover, as a shampoo and a conditioner, and as a facial moisturizer. But one of my favorite uses for this versatile oil is as an effective toothpaste.
All you need is coconut oil and baking soda. Combine the two ingredients in a small container and beat well till the mixture is smooth and not clumpy. Now, simply dip your toothbrush in and go to town on your teeth.
This way, I not only get an organic toothpaste that's both good for my teeth and the environment, but it's delicious as well. And since we've brought it up, a little later on, we're going to show you a delicious recipe featuring coconut as the star of the show.
I wasn't kidding when I said this fruit had nearly limitless uses. So hang tight for that wonderful recipe in a little bit. But for now, here's another great green feature. A bustling business district is a sign of progress. And as another premium building rises up on the Makati skyline, it also attempts to redefine the standards in constructing a building.
Well, technically, the Zuellig building is a 33-story office building that has been pre-certified to the gold level under the LEED core and shell program of the U.S. Green Building Council. So basically, it's a green building, but at the same time, it's also a very premium grade building here in Makati.
What sets the Zuellig building apart from other buildings around is that being green has been in the consciousness of the developer even before they broke ground.
From the very beginning, we've actually gone after the pre-certification process under the LEED core and shell program. So it's all in the design phase. So even before we break ground, we already have to prove that we're going after certain points. Going green is not an afterthought. It's really one of the two main focuses that the developer had in putting this building together.
Constructing a LEED certified building is no easy climb. Fortunately, Bridgebury Realty, the building's owners, enlisted the help of a reputable LEED consultant.
I'm Carla Cruz of Langdon Sea. We're the LEED consultants to this Zuellig building. We're also the cost consultants and quantity surveying consultants. Our president introduced our LEED services in 2008. We were just starting up.
The main drive of a LEED certification is one towards sustainability and environmental awareness. However, getting a certification doesn't mean conforming to a single building design.
LEED works like a shopping list. There are 5 categories under LEED, and from those you have certain criteria to meet. And if you meet those, you'll be gaining corresponding points. So a certified building here may be different from a certified building in another place. So it really depends on the practicable points or credits that the project is going to target.
So, what makes this building green?
As you can see, the building envelope, it's not just impressive aesthetically, but it also has high efficiency in terms of insulation. Of course, there's water efficiency. We're using 100% recycled water for irrigation. It is also supplemented with condensate water for flushing and other custodial purposes. And aside from water efficiency, there's also energy efficiency through proper selection of efficient HVAC system and use of or installation of different energy saving measures. For example, we have variable air valves instead of your constant airflow. And then the facade or the perimeter is lined with daylight harvesting sensors, and the whole office is installed with occupancy sensors. So one notable feature also of the building is the spacious area for greenery. It doesn't only encourages people to gather and socialize. In LEED, there's an aspect of protecting and restoring habitat. So there's a value to adding green spaces in an office building.
All these things contribute to the building's reduced carbon footprint and its environmental impact. But does it mean anything for the people inside the building? Well, there's no reason why it wouldn't.
There are a lot of studies relating LEED buildings to greater productivity in the offices, less absenteeism. Of course, as you can see how conducive working here with all the noise blocked off and then direct views to the outside. That alone increases productivity. And then, of course, to the employer or to the developer, the main catch for him is to save on operational expenses.
It's really just a good feeling working in that kind of environment, because we know from the very beginning that there are certain things that we have taken into consideration. Of course, One of them being energy, saving energy, saving water, and being able to have an indoor environment that is conducive to very efficient workspace. I mean, for me, it's great to be able to look up from my desk, to be able to see a window rather than seeing another wall. You actually get a lot of sunlight coming into the space. Also, one of the things that the LEED has actually required of us is to have only a 1 meter high office partition. So what that really helps with is not just the views so that the sunlight can actually get to the other people closer to the core, but it also does help with the productivity because it does induce more of a collaborative environment. So where you can turn around and you can see your other coworkers and you can just collaborate and talk to them more openly rather than having to get up and walk around to another office or another cubicle.
LEED does not only apply to the buildings itself. Individual office spaces can also aim for a separate LEED certification.
As you know, the interior space is applying for LEED certification also, although the base building is registered under a different LEED rating version, that's Core and Shell. But Core and Shell is supposed to be a supplement to commercial interiors. The developer should be encouraging its tenants to apply also. Just by occupying a LEED certified building, there are automatic points awarded to the project, I mean to the interior space.
All the efforts of establishing sustainable office spaces and buildings boil down to just one word, commitment.
When you ask me, what is the Zuellig building? Basically, you know, there's a very technical side to that. But to me, the Zuellig building is really commitment. It's commitment not just to sustainability, but it's also commitment to detail. And not just a commitment on the part of the developer. It's the commitment of the team that the developer has put together in order to put this building together. Everyone who's put this building together worked together to actually make this a reality. And it's also a commitment to the Philippines. The amount of investment coming into the building, not just the building structure itself, but from the companies that will be tenants of the building, really will show that this building in Makati is a world-class destination.
Welcome back to Green Living. Today we are all about the coconut. Now we've already seen the coconut used as an energy drink, as a moisturizer, and even as a base for toothpaste. But one of the most important uses of the coconut is as a fruit because its meat is delicious. Now today we're going to be making one of my most favorite recipes featuring coconut and its meat used to the fullest. We're going to be making baked coconut shrimp.
We're going to need 2 egg whites, 1.5 cups of panko or regular breadcrumbs, 1/2 teaspoon cumin, 3/4 cup flaked coconut, 1 garlic clove minced, pepper, and about 24 large shrimp, peeled, deveined, and butterfly. First off, we preheat the oven to about 500 degrees Fahrenheit. Spray a baking sheet with olive oil spray. Beat the egg whites in a bowl. In a small plastic bag, mix the panko, cumin, coconut, garlic, and pepper. Dip the shrimp in egg whites, then shake in the plastic bag to coat. Lay the shrimp on a baking sheet and bake for about 6 minutes per side until golden brown.
There it is. It looks delicious, doesn't it? And trust me, it tastes even better. Now, although the coconut shavings aren't the main part of this meal, it's certainly what gives it its unique flavor. It's both healthy and delicious, just the way I like it. I can't wait to sit down to a serving of this. So, for more tips and behind-the-scenes notes, you can log on to www.greenliving-tv.com or follow us on Twitter and like our Facebook page. I'll see you guys next week right here on Green Living. www.greenliving-tv.com. Hi. Or, if you're like me, you can choose something that's just less nutritious but is delicious.